kacamatanya masih di atas.
Kok salah sih?
Kok dia muter? Iya, coba lihat dulu.
Future issues and more than cooperation.
in Zurich Central Library, Universitas. Miss Christina, Ambassador of Sweden to Indonesia, Mrs. Johanna Bismar. Without any further ado, let's continue. Supriyana, PhD, as the moderator for today's lecture, and will be moderating the guest lecture. PhD, you are kindly invited to come forward.
Good afternoon, Bapak Ibu sekalian. I think I would like to. I see the people there, our student there. If you can move over here, silakan datang di depan supaya bisa dilihat. Silakan depan. Depan siapa?
Kurang tinggi deh, Pak. Tinggiin lagi deh.
Nanti videonya di-upload.
Di YouTube udah ada, Mbak? Di YouTube udah ada, di dalam.
Udah ada.
Oke, that's good. Happy to see you again. Everybody, good afternoon again. I would like to request Mr. Christina
Persson
and also Dr. Ibu Christina Persson, I said, Ibu with your name, or madam, in bahasa itu. So, Minister Christina Persson, Excellency, has been a long time in the government, because since 1971 to 73, she was Minister of Finance. So, once all the people has not been born yet, already Minister of Finance. But she was really up to 2014. She was working in many different governments and also a member of the European Parliament. So I think we are very lucky to have her here, because Minister has a lot of experience, especially in the sustainable and strategic development. And this really, I think, really good, this area. The other from Indonesia, from our university, is Dr. Kumari Papa, who is my working in the sustainable development, economy, and many other issues. Teaching at the University of Indonesia. So, ladies and gentlemen, I think that's the introduction to the two speakers, very prominent speakers. So, let me first, I think the arrangement will be after Excellency Minister's speech, or maybe within 20 or 30 minutes. Then we'll follow by Dr. Mubarak, who will explain about the Indonesia, maybe the same situation, maybe different. Then we'll have a Q&A, question and answer after that. So hopefully by 4:30 it will be finished, because I understand the Minister has to leave here earlier than 4:35. Okay, you must be very eager to hear this from Minister. So let's start. Thank you very much. So I'm glad to be asking Minister to start.
New means and ways of consuming and living, and this has resulted in the degradation of our ecosystem and environmental threats to our planet. And the first challenge of the world today is climate warming. Instruments to secure a safe pathway to sustainability. We have the technology, we have knowledge, but we don't have institution, and not only do we lack local institutions, some nations also like strong institutions, well-functioning institutions. And that is the most fundamental condition for good economic development, that you have strong institutions that are not corrupted, institutions. And that's one of the reasons I believe that Sweden is scoring quite well in international rankings, that we have a high degree of trust in our country and we have very low level of corruption. And therefore, for this reason, we can exchange knowledge with one another, because we are dependent on one another. We must solve our global common discussions with my Indonesian counterpart. That we will reach an agreement. And the reasons are that almost all countries have delivered their pledges to combat global warming, CO2 emissions. And at the same time, when you add up the result of all these pledges, you end up on a global temperature of somewhere between, well, around 3 degrees. The effect of the present pledges is not enough. We know that the limit that we might be able to handle is 2 degrees. We will also have problems, of course, in Sweden, and the verdict on, of course, migration flows that are much, much bigger than the ones that we have today. A lot of investment, the Paris conference, I expect, will provide us with one another, with more activity and more ambitious measures. As limitless and plentiful and robust. And instead, we must realize that we live on a very sensitive planet. We utilize the well-being of people without regard to how nature is perspective. And I see that the picture has already come up. The planet should be regarded as an asset that should be nurtured in a cautious way. And we should not economic. We have to work within the limits of nature. The ecological systems we do as politicians. Production, market forces, what we can achieve within the limits of nature. Our social goals. But as the professor said, I have been around quite a while, ever since the 70s and up to quite recently, it has been the other way around. problem sometimes. Family movies sometimes very bad for the people. We have heard to tell you a little bit about my of our work with sustainable concrete example of how we work with sustainable urbanization. Sustainable cities.
Somebody moving the pictures? Do this? Okay. There you are. Fine. So, and you have the picture? So this is more in order to do so, you have to have a perspective of work instead of more reactive, short-term perspective. And in order, this is necessary in order to facilitate the policy development and the decision making that really can address the brain societal and global challenges in a timely manner. And organizing my work in three different expert groups. It's begin with, it's what I've been talking about, mainly so far, the brain transformation. This expert group about the jobs in future, employment, and connected to that, the distribution of income. It's not only necessary to create employment, you must also have decent jobs and you must be able to live. And then the last, global cooperation, as I told you, we have global institutions. We need to strengthen global governance. You know that this conference also has the CO2 emissions fund. So we must reach in the world very rich countries must go in 2030 and 2050, it is expected to double. And the reason why this goes in the world around 10 billion in 2050. Everyone on the earth was living four planets. Even more if you lived in the way. But this is of course not the same. Emissions per capita in Sweden from but you can also see that China was where you are in 1990, and now they are emitting 7.2 per capita CO2 emissions
in 2012.
Now, if you would continue with the same production methods and the same utilization of energy, you would end up being as big an emitter as China has become. And if
Slovakia, but that we cannot stop the climate war. In Indonesia would completely disappear. And for the ocean, 3 kilometers Indonesia would be underwater.
As I said, the not only the
good, because it increases productivity and gives us more, but at the same time it takes loss of employment as a result of technological change, and that is mainly robotization. There is recent research in Sweden that has shown that as much as 50 care of education or culture, care of the elderly, and so on. So, in order to achieve that, we will need a lot of political measures. And I would say that the most important measure is education, lifelong learning, collaboration between companies and the public sector, to secure that people have the right skills to meet the demand from the of our work for sustainable cities is Hammar Beatrice. It's not very far from the city center. It's quite new. In the beginning of the 90s, this was degraded. Very unpleasant. Nothing was there. And now a whole new little city has been built on the site. And the what has been achieved so far with the high emissions that the all waste is recirculated and turned into energy for heating for the houses through the municipality organized heating system, the district heating system. In your case, it would be cooling system, I suppose. We are not cold country. So here they have 9 different functions for the recycling: paper, bottles, plastic, etc. And energy has gone down from 150 to 150 or 160 kilowatt per hour and square meter in houses to 180. And the environmental footprint has been reduced by 35 to 40%. So what are the secrets? Why did they succeed so well in Hamburg-Schiffbach? First and foremost, the political leadership was important.
not only long term but also short term. Nick Stern, the famous professor in UK, who came out with a report 10 years ago saying that to reduce emissions substantially, but it was much, much, much smaller than the long term cost that you would have by not doing it. Have a profit right away by doing so through your success on the market. So this is now the common understanding of our situation. Or views, then things can happen very, very quickly. So all we need to do is create the right condition for the market forces and behave as the public sector in the right way and achieve the good governance that we need. First of all, locally, nationally, but also globally. So thank you for listening.
I think this is really, really great talk. Hopefully, the number and statistic, showing that we are reducing the emission per capita in Sweden will not be above 3.8. So that will be 1,000 items. So if the more than 40 days, they predicted that 2,000 islands disappear. And to summarize also how that Sweden can reduce the emission, they also per capita, they also can develop sustainable way of doing. From water, from energy, from waste, everyone that is really ecological footprint is reduced. So I am really that way of doing. But we'll talk about that, how the Indonesia challenge with the world. This incoming month, December, there will be 195 countries will sit down together how to reduce the emission of the world, of all life. It's your life. If you can have continued it, then you can go.
Itu kita perlu 3 butuh pendukungnya. Jadi kira-kira kita sudah 25% overshooting.
Berusaha sekeras mungkin menghijaukan RPJMN
itu 2015-2019, the middle, medium term development plan. So the government has worked very hard to green, and then they did succeed to acquire the forest land compared to the government. Lalu opportunities untuk perubahan governance dan sektor reform itu juga banyak. Nah, kita perlu mengusahakannya bersama-sama. Oke, okay. Next. Beberapa pesan cepat aja background kondisi sekarang yang kita ada. Jadi ini cerita tentang kalau kita lihat indikator-indikator pembangunan ekonomi atau pembangunan bangsa pada dunia, baik aspek ekonomi maupun sosialnya. Nah, kita mengalami hal seperti ini. Pertumbuhan kita cepat dan kemudian juga naik cepat dalam 10 tahun dalam dekade 2000-an, sehingga poverty itu betul-betul turun dan dominan. Nah, tetapi sosial outcomes-nya menimbulkan banyak tanda tanya. Memang betul orang miskin itu berkurang, tapi apakah indikator itu realistis dalam kehidupan sehari-hari atau tidak realistis? Dan yang kedua, siapa yang menikmati pertumbuhan teori ekonomi mengatakan makin maju suatu negara, sektor primernya menurun share-nya di dalam GDP. Yang terjadi di Indonesia dalam 10 tahun ini tidak. Share dari GDP yang berasal dari primary sector, dari sumber, dari raw commodity itu meningkat. Jadi GDP maupun trade itu dalam keduanya share dari commodity itu meningkat. Berikutnya, dengan growth dan GDP yang sangat mengandalkan sumber daya alam tadi, sebetulnya kita sangat perlu memperhatikan rate of depletion, tingkat penyusutan sumber daya alam itu. Nah, ini yang masih sangat kurang diperhatikan. Anda bisa lihat di situ bagaimana pertumbuhan wealth kita yang terdiri dari produce capital, mesin-mesin, gedung, human resources juga termasuk produce capital versus natural capital. Jadi dalam tahun 2000 sampai 2005, ini indikator makro dari data internasional, ternyata natural capital kita itu sangat menurun. Nah, apa kaitannya dengan pertumbuhan? Kaitannya ya sederhana aja, karena pertumbuhan kita menandakan natural capital. Kalau kita makan modal. So at one point there will be no equity. Nah, lalu community intensive growth ini juga tercermin di dalam pola distribusi greenhouse gases kita. Jadi di sini terlihat bahwa land use dan forestry ditambah dengan kebakaran hutan itu menyumbang kira-kira 23 dari emisi di publik. Nah, energi hanya sekitar 22-25%. Nah, energi itu tadi yang menutup industri. Next, yang aneh sebetulnya satu anomali lain yang terjadi di kita. Ketika eksploitasi sumber daya alam, terutama tambang meningkat tajam, ternyata perannya di dalam penerimaan pemerintah itu menurun. Aneh kan? Oh, apa kok bumi dikuras menurun penerimaan pemerintah dari sektor pemerintah sendiri? Kemana ya? Bahwa Indonesia adalah eksportir terbesar ilir. Eksportir terbesar ilir tertib. Itu juga akan terjadi dengan batu bara. Jadi masih banyak hal yang harus dibenahi terkait dengan governance yang tadi dijalankan oleh itu. Berikutnya, yang juga disayangkan ketika kita tumbuh sangat cepat dalam dekade 2000 tadi sampai 2013, investasi pemerintah kita sekarang nggak bisa tumbuh karena ternyata infrastruktur kita lemah sekali, infrastruktur kita sangat kurang. So we are too lazy thinking at the time of the flood. Mudah-mudahan generasi berikutnya tidak begitu. Generasi saya, karena generasi kita yang sekarang duduk di kabinet. Ketidaksadaran untuk melakukan investasi di dalam menunjukkan bahwa kita sangat boros dalam menggunakan hutan. In Sweden, the forest area is growing. Yeah, I think so. But what the northern population is, the forest is growing. In here, we are still experiencing the high forest. Jadi itu contoh. Masih ada. Nah, ini indikator lain. Tadi ibu person mengangkat isu climate change secara besar itu gambarnya bisa kelihatan trennya. Lalu sementara saingan kita seperti Korea, Thailand, Brazil itu sudah melakukan langkah-langkah anomali sendiri, ya. Meskipun di China itu tren dari carbon content per carbon per kapita, carbon emisi per kapitanya masih meningkat, tetapi carbon per dolar GDP-nya itu sudah turun jauh dalam beberapa tahun. Jadi saya ada sepakat China dan Korea dan Thailand itu adalah saingan utama. Kita tidak bisa menurunkan carbon content di dalam GDP, carbon content di dalam ekspor kita. Ekspor market is the kemudian, kenapa karbon? bahan-bahan yang diberikan pemerintah sangat murah kepada orang kaya. Dan setiap orang menginap di hotel atau di mana mereka menikmati subsidi PLN. Di Indonesia dan menikmati listrik, makanya from June only to October, 3 juta orang dengan pasar. Pemerintah sudah berusaha keras dan sedang berusaha memperbaiki. Zero fossil fuel. Contoh ekstrem lain itu baik kita yang banjir penghapusan subsidi maupun semuanya menunjukkan we will do better if we can.
Additional strategy in Sweden. information, and we want to know. We are still, we are not given. We know that it doesn't have a lot. So we change basic framework that we know that human development index is the main factors to change the people.
Well, thank you very much, Graham, and sir, for a very great presentation. Also, of course, for Indonesia, but it's a game of the world because we need to solve this problem. Is that to do the things that able to increase. They are not seeing how good the environment conditions. They just see the economic growth. So how could Sweden or Indonesia be more prepared for this?
Social welfare system and development index that we have achieved. Well, it's also a really long story. I would say that we have had some luck. And of course, but we have also invested very early in education. And education for very early years. That is basic for economic development as well. And then, with the good economic development, we also invested in good public care, in good public sector, social services, social welfare system. That's one of the highest. But people get what they want from the taxes. It's a non-corrupt system. So that is basic, that people accept to pay taxes and that you have non-corrupt institutions. So then, Professor was right, governance, we agree completely in that matter that governance is everything. It's
kegamanan kalau kebijakan. Some people who are in charge are quite
make in their mind, yeah, if you are going to go there,
to present the one who in